I would like to give a warm welcome to parents, grandparents, siblings, relatives, friends, the Neil McNeil staff, guest speakers, and most of all, the graduates, especially those who actually made it here on time today. You'll see what I mean later. This event is the culmination of 4 years of hard work by students, staff, and of course, you, the parents. Not unlike the iconic ducks of Central Park in the classic novel, The Catcher in the Rye, our graduates are ready to take flight. Some, like those ducks, already know their destination, while others, like the confused protagonist, Holden Caulfield, may still be uncertain where their paths will lead them. Be that as it may, this will be a wonderful evening for all to celebrate where they have been. And so, let us begin our graduation exercises for 2014. Please stand for the processional of staff and graduates. Thank you. begin, I would like to ask Enrique Olivo to please come up and lead us in prayer. Enrique, are you here?
Let us begin with the sign of our faith. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Graduates and all gathered here, let us pray our new McNeil School prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who instructed the hearts of your faithful, by the light of the Holy Spirit, grant us that by the same Holy Spirit to be truly wise, and ever rejoice in his consolations. Christ our Lord. Amen. Holy Spirit, our Lady of Perpetual Help,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Deacon. I would now like to invite Mr. Mike Wallace, our principal, to come up and open the proceedings by saying a few welcoming words of wisdom. Mr. Wallace, ladies and gentlemen.
In some ways, this context is similar to today's world. The profound changes that have led to the ever-spreading multicultural societies require those who work and study in schools to become involved in the educational programs of exchange and dialogue, and with a bold and innovative fidelity to be able to bring together the Catholic identity to meet the different souls existing in our multicultural society. So again, We're asking you, as we ask of ourselves, to include everybody, to be all-inclusive, and to make sure that we are disciplined in our pursuit of truth and listen to everything, all sides, before we draw conclusions. And I think if we've been inspired to do that by your teachers and your peers, then we've accomplished something. The third thing that I wanted to leave you with was something that a parent left me. It was a message, something that he said I didn't really understand it, and then I realized it was from a different faith tradition, so I want to read it to you. This was a lesson in time, which is, I think, what's going to happen. You know, as you leave school, you're going to experience things over time, and when you come back and see us, we want to hear your stories. But this said, when a bird is alive, it eats ants. And when the bird is dead, the ants eat the bird. Time and circumstances can change at any time. Don't devalue or hurt anyone in your life. You may be powerful today, but remember, time is more powerful than you. One tree makes a million matchsticks, but only one matchstick is needed to burn a million trees. There's that fire commitment. So, as you proceed through this particular ceremony and leave tonight, I want you to just keep this in mind. Look after each other. Walk humbly. Be happy. Come back and visit with us on alumni nights because we want to hear your stories. Congratulations to you and to your parents.
School trustee, Ms. Nancy Crawford, to the podium. It is now her turn to enlighten you all.
Principal Wallace, family members, staff, and to you, the graduates, good evening. I am very pleased to be here at this wonderful celebration and to bring greetings on behalf of the Board of Trustees of the Toronto Catholic District School Board. I have had a very exciting day. This morning, I attended my son's graduation from Seneca College. My son, Kevin, also graduated from Neil McNeil. You may find it interesting that the president of Seneca College talked about the importance of the same skills that your teachers have been helping you to develop for the past 4 years. See if some of these sound familiar. Critical thinking, problem solving, communication, and teamwork. Feel confident that you are well prepared for your future. Back to you, the graduates. This is your night. As you bid farewell to secondary school, it is the perfect time to look back on your many accomplishments while also looking forward to the new challenges and varied experiences that life will bring. Regardless of the pathway you have chosen, university, college, apprenticeship, or the workforce, may you always apply the Catholic values and critical skills that you have developed in the past 14 years to whatever lies ahead. Graduates, we hope for you. You are full of promise. You are gifted and skilled. We have high expectations that you will continue to develop yourselves, contribute to the global community, and be disciples of Jesus Christ. Graduates, we need you. The world needs you. The church needs you. We are counting on you to fully engage yourselves with the world and to apply yourselves to the problems that we have today. We are counting on you to be responsive to the needs of others and the needs of planet Earth. Graduates, we love you and we appreciate you. We thank you for your contribution to the Toronto Catholic District School Board throughout the past 4 years. We will continue to support you and encourage you, and our prayers are with you. Tonight, we also celebrate the enduring love, guidance, and care that that your parents have given you throughout your elementary and secondary school years. Parents, you are to be commended for the support and encouragement that you have lovingly provided, and you should be proud of the important part that you have played in your graduate success. Teachers, we thank you for all that you have helped your students to learn and for being Christian role models, both inside and outside the classroom. We know that education extends beyond the classroom walls. I commend you for your unselfish commitment to our students in after-school activities, ranging from athletics to the arts, from chaplaincy to other leadership opportunities, and in a wide range of diverse extracurricular activities that may have taken your students around the corner or around the world. These rich learning opportunities have allowed each graduate to develop skills and attitudes that will carry you forward as capable, confident, and successful learners throughout their lives. The word graduate comes from the Latin word gradus, meaning step. Each step along your path to graduation has been guided by the people gathered here tonight. Your families have laid a solid foundation for your education and your future success. Your principal and vice principals, teachers and school staff have served as role models and mentors, encouraging you to strive for high academic standards while inspiring you to apply Christian values to life's opportunities, challenges, and choices. Our priests and parishes have also played an important role in your growth and development, especially the spirits and fathers, providing you with spiritual guidance and encouragement. And I hope that your own peers have provided friendship that will last a lifetime. May you continue to be, as your parents, teachers, and the church have said, positive role models who reflect the Catholic graduate expectations as collaborative contributors, caring and responsible citizens, creative thinkers, and lifelong learners. May you find that your future is indeed bright, and that your years at Neil McNeil have prepared you to transform the world through witness, faith, innovation, and action. Sincere congratulations. I wish you much success in the years ahead. God bless each one of you.
Thank you, Ms. Crawford. Next in the agenda is the keynote address, and the keynote speaker this year is Mr. Mark Kelly of CBC News. Mr. Mark Kelly has a career that spans more than two decades at CBC News, including his award-winning work as an investigative journalist, as co-host of CBC News Disclosure. Most recently, Mr. Kelly hosted Connect, CBC News Network's primetime news program, highlighted the personal stories behind the day's headlines. As the face of Connect, Mr. Kelly won a Gemini Award in 2011 for best host or interviewer in a news information program. He has won four other Geminis for his work with CBC News Disclosure, The National, hosted by that other somewhat well-known guy, Peter something, right? CBC News Morning, and CBC's Beijing Olympic Broadcast. You may know some of our international students. Originally from Montreal, go Leafs go, and a graduate of Concordia University, Mr. Kelly lives in Toronto with his wife and four boys, two of whom attend our school, Isaac in grade 9 and Aiden in grade 10. I expect that the other two boys will follow in due time. Right, Mr. Kelly?
Right.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give to you the CBC's Mr. Mark Kelly.
Principal Wallace and our distinguished guests and our proud, proud parents and relatives who are all here tonight. Good evening to you, and of course, to all the students who are here. Good evening. Isn't it great? I love looking out at you guys. This is the hottest day of the year. So what does your school do? They call this a graduation book. What they do is they put you in these unbreathable black robes, and then they make you sit through long speeches. This isn't graduation, folks. This is called revenge. Deal with it, okay? Because I got a long speech. And there was some apprehension because I came in here right at the last minute, and truth be told, the trustee was saying she had a great day. I had a great day today. I actually started my day in a marijuana grow up. Kids, as I mentioned by Sergio, I have two kids here attending the school, Isaac, and when I came home from work the other day, he said, "Dad, is it true that you're going to be speaking in graduation class?" And I said, "Yeah, I am," and I felt kind of proud, like my kid was proud of me. Like he was thinking, "Hey, my dad's kind of a big deal." But instead, he looked at me and he was like, "Why? Why you?" So I said, "Maybe I'll have a little bit more luck with my second son." So Aiden tonight, as I was getting ready, he looks at me and he says, I said, "Are you going to come and listen to my speech?" And he looks at me and he says, he's looking for his words, he's a little wobbly and shaky on his feet. He says, "No, that's just weird." And I said, "Weird?" And he said, no, that's not the right word. And I said, "Okay, good, because that kind of put me off." He said, "That's creepy." So I stand here before you tonight, humbly and humbled by my own boys, but honored to be here to speak with you. So why am I here? Well, I'll tell you why. It was mentioned, I have two boys here, and I hope one day I will be sitting where you are, parents, proud, looking at your kids. And I hope my kids will be sitting where you guys are one day, graduated students. But given their performance this year, that's not a given. So why am I here? Well, when Principal Wallace called me, I responded like that. I said, "Absolutely, I'll be here." And it's because I hope I would inspire my kids to lead and succeed. But more than that, I hope that at the end of the day, Mr. Wallace would feel like he owed me one. This is something called quid pro quo. And kids, you need to learn this. It's like, I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine. This is the motto for the school of life. And you need to learn that. You need to remember that. But of course, your motto is something a little bit more noble. It is fidelis est in arduis, or faith in hard times. And I am sure that each and every one of you students here have gone through a period of hard times in your past few years to get where you are today. And I am positive that all you parents and family members have been through some hard times too, to make sure your kids be sitting up here, and I commend you for all that. But you have to remember that hard times make us who we are. Hard times prepare us for the future. They make us more resilient, and at the end of the day, they give us courage. And courage is what we need to succeed. I'll tell you why. When I finished high school, I wasn't sure where my life would take me. I knew I wasn't going to be a doctor, or a scientist, or an engineer. I just didn't have marks like that. I didn't have the skills like that. But I made a deal with myself. I said, whatever I do, I'm going to do it well. I'm going to be a success. But without that career path that some of you may have already charted out, others are probably still looking for, take your time. You'll find it. I was saying, what could I draw on? What have I done in my life? And there was only one thing I had really done. I'd been a student. Like all of you, I'd been a student. What I didn't realize is understanding that that was my skill was going to be a turning point in my life. I went to university. I went to Concordia University. I studied journalism, and I really fell in love with journalism. I realized this was my calling. I got a degree. I started working as a radio reporter.
looking for that time where I could be that success that I really wanted to be. But as I started to realize that was going to take time. Then I got a call to get a big break that I could be a TV reporter. I was going to be a reporter at the legislature in New Mexico, the Assembly Nacional. Huge break for me. This was going into an incredible political, a time of political turmoil in this country that was leading up to our second referendum. This was my big break. So I thought. And then I went on TV, and you know what? I was the worst TV reporter you've ever seen in your life. I was awful. And what should have been a point of pride for me as I looked up and I saw myself in the 6 o'clock news, instead I felt like crawling under my desk. So I went back to the thing I knew, being a student, and that meant learning. And I had to learn how to do my job. And I did. And I graduated, slowly but surely, with that courage, I got better at it. Then I was given another big break where they wanted to hire me to be the news anchor on the morning show. So I moved the family up to Halifax to do that. I thought, how hard could this be? And you know what? I was terrible. I was stiff. I was uncomfortable. I was in a suit and tie. I was miserable up there, and it showed on the TV. And it killed me because I had to make my mistakes in public. But those hard times made me stronger. And they gave me more courage. So here I was, working through this in those early days, trying to build my courage. And I was phoned at home, because I used to work, it was the morning show, and I was phoned at home one night. And they said, Mark, we need you to get to work. And what had happened is a plane had crashed close to Halifax. It was Swiss Air Flight 111. There were 229 people on board. The plane had gone down in the ocean near Peggy's Cove. They said, we want you to anchor our coverage. You got to get here right away. So I did. I mustered up all that courage and realized this was going to be a moment where I'm going to go through hard times. And I'm on the air, and I'm doing the best I can. And then they come in my telex earpiece, and they say, we just found out that CNN is now picking up our coverage. You are now broadcasting around the world. Folks, I was not ready for prime time. But there was no turning back. So I was on the air for 13 straight hours, doing my best. And as I had said to myself all along, as I was learning, being a student, learning what I could do and how I could do my job, I said, you've always got to keep an open mind. You've always got to keep an open mind. You've got to keep yourself open to learning. And minds are like parachutes. They only work when they're open. And this was my moment. Keep that open mind to get through those 13 hours to succeed. And I did that. And then I was rewarded with being named the host of that morning show, and they moved me to Toronto. So I came in and I was learning my job. It was a new skill set that I had to learn. And I showed up for work one morning, sat down, and said, all right, world, bring it on. And that day was September 11th, 2001. When someone came into my ear and said, Mark, my director said, we're hearing reports of a fire in one of the World Trade Towers. What do we do? I said, well, we go live with it. This is a big story. If there's a fire in a skyscraper, we had no idea. So we went live. We were the first broadcaster in Canada to go live with what would be the day that would change the world as we know it. And we got through that. I watched that second plane fly in. I watched the people jumping from that building. I watched the plane go into the Pentagon, and I was live on TV. And the world was watching. And I prayed for that parachute to open, to guide me safely. And this was a moment, and my point for you is you never know when your moment will come. But being a student, being prepared for those hard times, having that open mind is what is going to make you resilient. It's going to give you the courage to take these things on. In the coming years, I'd find myself live on air for the 7/7 attacks in London. I was guest hosting a radio show when it happened for CBC. The Haiti earthquake, the Arab Spring in Egypt, when I was caught in a situation where I didn't think I would escape with my life, but thank God that I did. And I decided I needed something a little bit more relaxed, so I went to cover the war in Afghanistan. But I still stand here before you today, and as I've mentioned, I fill in often for Peter Mansbridge, and I was live just the other night, and they said, don't worry, Mark, it's a quiet night. It'll be an easy show. And then we heard that three Mounties were shot dead in Moncton, and I was But throughout that time, that parachute, that open mind, has carried you safely back to Earth. And that's what you need to equip yourself with. And sure, it's been mentioned that I have awards. That's great. But more than anything, I can look back now and say, you know what? I can't believe I did all these things. And that's a great feeling. And it's much better feeling than saying, boy, I wish I had done something more. Because one thing you don't want is regret. Change and challenges, they're not easy. You're about to experience what that's all about. They really test you. But regret is even worse. Regretting you've done more. Regretting that maybe you should have tried that after all. And there's another thing you want to avoid, and that's apathy. Apathy is you looking at your world and saying, you know what? I don't care. That's not good enough. Apathy is the enemy. I have traveled this country back and forth for my job. I have hitchhiked across this country for my job. I have driven a Winnebago across this country for my job. I have taken planes, trains, and automobiles across this country for my job. I have talked to Canadians from coast to coast to coast. And I have asked them about issues, big and wide. And the one answer that drives me crazy is, I don't care. Folks, if you don't care, then you don't have the right to complain. And I bet if I ask your parents right here, you've all done your fair share of complaining. So if you want to complain about something, you've got to get involved. You have to believe that you can make a difference. I know Mr. Principal Wallace has spoken to you about politics, and politics is a way where you can get involved in your community. Because this school has taught you about community. It's taught you about leadership and fellowship and brotherhood. And there's so many ways that you can use that to make a difference in your world, in your life. Running for politics is one option. You can do it at any level, whether you're doing your school, your city, or your province, or your country. Folks, any one of you could be the next Rob Ford. In fact, if any of you want to run for mayor, we think that would be a great idea about right, get done right now, too. Not a great example, but still, my point being, you may not realize it now, but you can, whether it's in your home or beyond that, make a difference. My dad, God bless his soul, lived by a simple credo. He would say, God, make me necessary to someone today. Just that. And is that too much for you to ask? Just finding a way for you to make yourself necessary to somebody. You're all here today, your students, your successful students. You've graduated. But your life as a student isn't over. In many ways, it's just beginning. But the best part is, folks, it gets better. This is the part where you find out who you are. And those are exciting times. Now, if none of this has resonated with you, and maybe some of it hasn't, then I will refer to the words from the great prophet, Will Ferrell. Have you guys seen the movie The Internship? Yeah, I love that movie. And my favorite scene in it is when Will Ferrell's in that movie. He's the guy who owns the mattress store. And you remember, he had the tattoo on his neck, written in Sanskrit. And what did it say? And these are the words you can live by. Make reasonable choices. It's an odd thing to have tattooed on your neck in Sanskrit, but so he did. And if you remember nothing else in your life, and I think your parents will support me, make reasonable choices. But more than anything, graduates, in the spirit of this great school that I really hope my four boys will graduate from one day, Principal Wallace, in the spirit of this great school, don't just do well, do good. Thank you.
Mr. Kelly, those words of wisdom, And you're a funny guy, too. What's that? Don't talk to me. We finally get to the important part. Not to say that speeches are not important, but we get to the conferral of diplomas, and I will ask Mr. Noble and Ms. Wong to come up and confer the diplomas at this point. Again, just a reminder that there will be pictures taken, official pictures, and there's a video. So if you want to take pictures, please just stay on the side as much as possible. Thank you. Are we ready to begin? The first name, Nicholas Abate. David Alarcon. Renee Alvarez, Chisholm, and Service Scholar and Gold Service Award. That's for $500 of community service. Mateo Alvarez, Ontario Scholar. Philip Ambrosovitz. Justin Antoine. Gilbert Appia. Adrian Arichetta. Daniel Arqueza. Mika Ashbridge. Someone's officially here, he's wearing white pants. Kaiser Alonso. Dominic Beardmore. BJ Vinson. Daniel Basalon. Andrew Bombassi. Nicholas Bomers, Ontario Scholar. Carter Rockerville. Carlos Buenmaceo. Excuse me, who's standing behind you there. Mark Burns. Alexander Callender. Kieran Campbell. Christian Carr. Onshin Chen, Ontario Scholar. He's not here. Is Tamim here? Tamim Chowdhury, Ontario Scholar, not here. Alessandro. Alessandro Chiracco. Shane Chignano. Alessandro Coppa. Gabriel Ornacchia Schism. Joseph Edward, Ontario Scholar. Aljon Aroles. Ricardo Ricky Escamilla. Susan. Matthew Faber. Wenzie Faber. Zachary Feeney. Mark Feolino. Jonathan Fernandez. Shane Fernandez, Ontario Scholar, and Mark Florante Chisholm. Ryan Flores. Alejandro Gaona Pinzón. Juan Manuel Gaona Pinzón. Jerwin Garcia. Eliana Burgess. Theodore Gomes Chisholm. Nigel Gomes, not you. Daniel Goodyear. Bryce Gordon. Dakota Gray. John Guevara. James Kumatai. Stephen Harlan, Ontario Scholar. Thank you. this next name, and I'll do it both ways. One the English way, and one the Czech way. I'll do the English way first. Matthew Roach, or Matthew Roch. Lorenzo Jiang, Ontario Scholar. Matthew. Floyd Jones, Ontario Scholar. Michael Jordan Humes, Rubber Resident.
What a cutie!
Thomas. Dave Medina. Miguel Mello, Shizum. Kenny Miao, Ontario Scholar. Tristan Murat. Julian Kelly, Ontario Scholar. Hervé Morana. Joseph Moriello. Christian Nahar, Ontario Scholar. Derek Newell. No. Henry Nguyen, Ontario Scholar. Ryan Nichols, Ontario Scholar. Lucas Nitiyoga. Cal O'Donoghue, Ontario Scholar. Enrique Olivo, Shizum, Ontario Scholar for Tourism Award. Jason Orpia. James Pasqua, Ontario Scholar. Michael Pasquale, Ontario Scholar. Zachary Passmore. Jake Canoldo from Ontario's College. Brendan Pennymurphy, Ontario Scholar. Biggs Perrins. Gautam Perinpanayagam. Ethan Peter. Antonio Scarfone, Ontario Scholar. so. Please stand. Jose Servino. Everybody's a comedian. Xavier Sulao Shizum. Paul Simon. Michael Sorrevilla, Ontario Scarborough. Alexander Soriano. Cameron Stewart. Angelo Sundaraja. Daniel Sutcliffe. Eric Taylor. Jonathan Texon. Anthony Tejon. Joshua Thomas. Gabriel Thierry. David Tosi or Tochi, Thomas Connor. Franklin Tolentino. Eric Muron. Andres Vergara. Luis Valen. Luis de la Corta. Nicholas Hoot, Ontario Scholar. Eric Wong. Alexander Wildermichael. Schimmel Richard Nathan. Frank G. Ontario Scott. June. Roman Yoon from Charles Donnelly. Bradley Zhang from Terrace College. Kang Zhang, Ontario Scholar. And of course we have Troy Zhang. Liu Zhang. Last but certainly not least, Wang Tang Zhu. Politics, the winner is...
Peter!
Antonio Scarfone. Jealous. For society, challenge, and change, the winner is Mitchell Nader. Thank you, Mr. Tagliardini. Next, I will ask Ms. Pond to please come up. The Computer Science Award, Subject Award. Of course, Subject Awards is self-explanatory. If you get the highest mark, you get the award. And the winner is Boria Picos. Thank you, Ms. Pond. Next. I would ask Ms. Gallant to please step up. This is the Co-op Boya Award, and the winner is Anderson Diaz. Ms. Anderson, would you please do us the honor of presenting the Dramatic Arts Award? Now this is a two winners actually. These two guys are actually gonna, once they leave, they're gonna get an apartment together and become the odd couple, as they say. So Oscar Madsen and Felix Unger, please come on down. James Dick and Neil. Award is of course the most important one, it's the English Award. What do you mean boo? Ms. Kiriakou, please come down. If you can't get 7, it's not my fault. The winner is, I told you to stay up here, Antonio Scarfone. You got like 78. On the History Award, I would ask Mr. Diaz. And the winner is Christian Nahon. Tamim Chowdhury. afternoon.
Five winners, so I'm just going to call out the names and the name, please.
WCO Awards are Shane Fernandez, Marisha Jean, Enrique Olivo, Brendan Pennyworthy, and Louis Clancy. Donated by the Toronto Secondary Unit of OECTA to a student with a minimum of 75 average who has demonstrated an interest in and commitment to social and political action. And I would ask Mr. Colangelo to please come up and present the award. This special student is Enrique Olivo. Next award is the Lieutenant Governor Community Volunteer Award. It was founded by the Lieutenant Governor and it's donated by Danny Passmore and the Spiritans to the student who has demonstrated exemplary volunteer activity. And I would ask Ms. Nancy Crawford to please come up and present this award. And the winner of the Lieutenant Governor Community Volunteer Award, Thomas Disbro. Mr. Scalpello, if you would please come up to present the next award. The next award is known as the Slim Hooker Award. It's donated by Ms. Wendy Hooker, former VP of Neil McNeil. And it goes to the student who exhibits excellence in technological design and commitment to community service. The winner is Ryan Nichols. Award is the Father Peter Fleming Memorial Award. And this award is donated by Paul Iacono to the graduating student who has consistent top English marks in all 4 years of high school. And I would ask Ms. Kiriaki to please present this award. The winner, once again, Antonio Scarfone. Interestingly enough, Tony here doesn't want to go into journalism or anything like that. He wants to go into medicine. Mr. Fiorina, would you please come up to present the next award? Agent Award, and it's donated by Josh Catering to the student who has combined academic excellence with something endeavors. Academic endeavors. It's actually athletic endeavors. Yeah, yeah, funny, eh? I'm up here, you're down there. And the winner of the Al Bacon Award, Justin Massa. Nicholas Orange. Next award is the Catholic Student Leadership Award. And Mr. Cummings, if you please. It's donated by Brian Brown and Dr. Lombardi to the student whose school involvement typifies the objectives of a Catholic school. The Catholic Student Leadership Award goes to Enrique Leon. For the next award, I would ask Ms. Nancy McMullen, please to come up, the Seaside Chair. And it's the Governor General's Medal Somerville Scholarship Award. It is founded by the Governor General, donated by Just Catering and Joyce McDonald. The graduating student who attained the highest average using between 11 and 12 marks. This year we have two winners. And the winners are Antonio Scarfone, Mitchell Newman. Thank you. The Warren Brown Award, donated by the Spirit of Fathers and Paul Yocono, goes to the graduating student who demonstrates leadership, academic excellence, and extracurricular activities are involved. And I would ask Mr. Jason Wood to please come. The Warren Brown Award goes to Kenny Miao. Next award, I would ask Ms. Wong to please come up. And it is the Neil McNeil Spirit Award in honor of Fenton Kilbride. This is donated by the Spirit and Fathers, and it goes to the student who demonstrates leadership in promoting spirit and a positive tone within the school. This year's winner, Kafui Dosu. Christian service and leadership. This year, there are two winners. They are Shane Fernandez and Narushin. is the Father John Shepherd Golf Scholarship. This is also donated by Paul Iacono, a generous man. And it goes to the student who best demonstrates the tradition of the game in golf, a level of competence combined with an appreciation of history, etiquette, and demeanor that is required of the sport. And the winner is Tyler LeBlanc. Cummings, would you please do us the honor of presenting the award? This year's winner, Ryan Nichols.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, fellow colleagues, and Neil graduates. This evening, I have the pleasure of introducing to you a fellow Neil McNeil alumnus. Our guest is a man who has been the driving force behind the prestigious Father Troy Bursary, which will be given out this evening for the fourth time. He has, together with his fellow Neil McNeil classmates, been working on this project for many years. He is a fine man who knows Neil McNeil very well, and who continues to provide support to the students of Neil McNeil in various ways. He has shared many great stories about Neil McNeil, from the challenges in the late 1960s and early 70s, to the numerous class photos of successful graduates which cover the walls of the first floor. We are honored to have such a distinguished gentleman join us this evening to present this bursary. From the graduating class of 1969, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Mr. Michael Goddard.
But it was really important to understand just how powerful, what that really means, that you will go through whatever it takes to get the job done. Faith in hard times, we called it stick-to-itiveness, if you will. And I want you guys to look around. Take all this in. This is a special night. This night will last with you all your life. Some of the friends you've made over the years will be with you for the next 50 years, as some of my friends are. Guys that I met in high school that I still hang out with. And even if you only see them once in a while, maybe at our alumni reunions that we have in November. And you know what you'll do? You'll sit around the table. You might have a couple of adult beverages. And you're going to tell little white lies about what it was like when you were in Yale. And that's neat to do. And that's a relationship and relationships that will last with you for a very, very long time. It's really special. But there's something that I forgot to do 50 years ago. And I'm hoping you guys can help me write a little bit of a mistake. And this is probably the only time where all the people that have supported you in your high school here, your family, your crime support, your friends, and of course, the teachers and dedicated teachers and staff at Neil that have really, really encouraged, supported, directed, led, and taught you. You know, all of these folks really have done a heck of a job or you wouldn't be here. So you know what? We're going to turn around and give them a Neil thank you. Come on, guys. Principal. I was actually at the school from 59 to 64. Mr. Colangelo's dates were slightly off. But that's all right. I don't think he teaches math. Anyway, our principal, Father Troy, I think you may have heard me say this around Christmas, that his nickname was Big Daddy. That's what everybody called him. Father Big Daddy, Michael Troy. So this bursary is really, really geared towards the student that's had to really battle the elements. And this is really a special, special bursary. It's not awarded, it's actually earned. The person that's going to receive it tonight has earned it. And once again, as we had the last 4 years, or the last previous 3 years, this is my fourth, we had a real challenge to select the one recipient. What we're hoping is we can increase our funding and hopefully have more than just the one bursary that we're going to be giving out tonight. But let me assure you that this is a special deal to receive this bursary. It shows true fortitude, courage, and all of the good qualities that anybody would want in any person. So I think that what we should do, without further ado, is Mr. Colangelo, maybe we should get on with the show.
At this point, I'd like to invite all the New McNeil staff who are alumni to the stage, and I'd like to extend that invitation to any New McNeil alumni that are in the audience, that are family and friends. Please come up to the stage at this time.
To announce the winner of the Father Troy Alumni Bursary for 2014. And that person is Eric Uhl. Thank you, Mr. Ryle. Next on the program, we have the Spiriton Scholarships, and I would ask Mr. Cummings to please come up to present them. I'm going to call the names of the winners, the recipients, all come up together, please. The winners are Enrique Olivo, Zed McClellan, Nick Homers, Mark Fiolino, Thomas Isbro, and Louis Milan. Enrique and Lewis, please to stay behind. Intentions are detentions. Special reason. Lewis Milan, and I'm going to ask Ms. Crawford to please come up to present this, is the recipient of the Fintan Kilbride Memorial Scholarship. Let me just say a few words about that.
Family and Friends of Vinton Kilbride established this annual award in memory of Vinton Kilbride, who was a teacher with the Toronto Catholic District School Board for 17 years. He was dedicated to the development of the third world countries and shared this dedication with his students. The award is to be granted to an eligible recipient who has formed his or her commitment to the gospel values of social justice for the poor and or marginalized, and who has contributed service relevant to this commitment. You are to be congratulated for your contribution to the school community, your commitment to gospel values, and your interest in social justice issues, which have made you a most suitable candidate for this award. The winner is Louis Blanc. Is the recipient of the Tom Leon Student Bursary. That's, well, I'll say it, $5,000. This bursary is awarded annually to two graduating female students and two graduating male students. Require financial assistance in order to pursue studies at a post-secondary institution. Each award is designated for the cost of tuition in the amount of $5,000. And Enrique is this year's recipient. He is to be awarded the U of T Book Award. And this goes to a student who can actually read. And it is a book about the history of the U of T, and it goes to obviously someone who is going to study at U of T and also goes to the And so we finally arrive at the moment of truth. The valedictorian's address. Speech of the evening. I hope. Hey, come on. The valedictory address. This year's valedictorian, as chosen by his fellow graduates, is none other than Christian Carter.
For me to interact with those who I previously knew and for those I did not. And first time. As a group, we witnessed Father Obina turn a mass into a mosh pit. And were welcomed into the Brotherhood by senior students. As the days and months went on, we became more familiar with one another and our true colors started to show. Eventually, we discovered that Brian Galazzo developed so much passion that he became a rugby decided to change his surname to DeRugby. We also learned that Neil McNeil has now become a farm system for McDonald's employees. But seriously, the school gave us the opportunities we needed in order to find out what truly interests us and what inspires us to do our best work. At Neil McNeil, not only does the curriculum include math, science, and English, we also learned very important life lessons from the faculty. It was Mr. Mahavik who taught us that it's okay to answer your cell phone as long as you have two kids. We also learned from Mr. Kennedy that regardless of how many warnings he gives out, he will never follow through. That Neil McNeil staff is one of the best in the business. They taught us all the necessary work ethics and values that are required to become successful in life. I would like to thank all the teachers for their hard work and dedication, even when we were the most cooperative. One thing though I'm not thankful for them is the phrase, take your hat off. Thank God I never have to hear that again. The staff are not the only ones who need to be thanked. Arguably the biggest thanks must go to sparknotes.com. Sparknotes basically allowed us to complete 4 years of English, because who knows what we would have been. Fidelitas in Artibus, meaning strength in our times, is the school model. At Neil, we live by this every day, and we're there to lend a helping hand. This was in full display when we saw the loss of a former Neil brother, Nebby Tedesi. Nebby may not have been in this grade, but I cannot describe the impact he had on all of us. This unfortunate event was able to bring us together as one in the Neil community. The church was flooded with Neil students past and present as we were there to pay our respects to our fallen brother and show support for his family. This quality is one that we shall be proud of. What I truly love most about this school is the unity we share. Being at the school for 4 different years and seeing 7 different classes of students, I can proudly say this class was unified more than any other. It didn't matter if you were Asian, white, or black. We all treated one another with respect and dignity. If I wanted to play ball with Jose and Angelo, I would be welcome with open arms. I never did, but if there was a time where I didn't want to create a hot track, Brennan Heron and Vernon Marie seemed to be this gave me the assurance that he was the best for me. Okay, let's rewind and take a look at some of the events that made Neil such a special place. Just before the Christmas break, we held the annual Huli Dance and Talent Show. This gave the students the opportunity to showcase their skills and talents in front of their peers. The main attraction, though, was, of course, the dance, in which we were constantly reminded to leave room for the Holy Spirit. Winter activity offered us the freedom to choose between activities ranging from curling to skiing. The one drawback was that about half the students chose to go to the buffet and movie. It is called winter activity after all. I'd like to talk about the box run, but I don't think there's too much I can touch on tonight. One event that showed promise in its inaugural inception was at the first carnival last year. That promise quickly shifted to anger as about 63 students showed up for it. We could go on and on reflecting on the great times we've shared together at Neil, but now we must look forward to what lies ahead of us. Most of us won't be wearing the maroon sweater come early September, so the ride is over at this point. Wherever you are going, whether it's college, university, or the workplace, remember the lessons we've learned. Remember that everyone has a story that makes them the person they are. Remember to do unto others as you have them do unto you. Remember that without failure, there is no success. But most of all, remember that Mr. Rosa loves the Trailer Park Boys. As Mr. DeFlore would say, I don't want to take too much of your time, so this is the part where I end it. Every single one of you for making these 4 years at Yale the best anyone can ask for. Good luck to you all as you journey through the rest of your lives. Thank you for coming. Have a great night, and I need you in our future.
A round of applause, please, for Ms. Gallant, Ms. Gonzalez, Ms. Kyle, Ms. Figueroa, Ms. Carrington, Ms. Paul, Ms. McDonald, and on the hand, Ms. McDonald, Ms. McDonald, Ms. McDonald. Another special award called the Rosa Special Award. So I'm going to ask four gentlemen to come up here to get their awards. There's Josh Malay, Jack Madigan, Vernon Mariasilin, and Michael Jordan Hume. Are they getting awards? Now, they're all wonderful kids. I love them all. I love them all. But there's a bad, bad habit of being late. It really grinds my gears. These guys are in my first period class, and they have top prize in being late. Except for one, Michael Jordan Humes. He gets another one, but you'll see. I'm going to start with Josh Malay. He gets the number one award. Beads, and of course, a dinosaur. Because every boy loves a dinosaur. A late great dinosaur. Jack Madigan. And Vernon. Europe, and unfortunately he suffered a setback. He lost his backpack. We could not find it. We bought one in Prague, but it wasn't the same, so I thought I would get him one this time. I spent my own money, hard-earned money. I'm going to give Michael his new backpack. Backpack. excellent sisterhood. Thank you, gentlemen. Now, I need a volunteer, preferably a Neil alumni, to come and join me in leading the graduating class in the school song. Music.